Hello, welcome back to the TradTalk podcast. Today I have an international interviewee from, actually she's my neighbor. She's in Buenos Aires. She lives in Buenos Aires, so it's Paula Arturo. Hi, Paula.
Hi, Caroline.
How are you?
Good, how are you?
I'm all right, thank you. Thank you very much for accepting my invitation to talk to the podcast listeners. It's a pleasure to welcome you here.
And thank you. Thank you for having me. It's my pleasure as well.
Well, for those who don't already know her and should, so please Google her or something. Her name is Paula Arturo. She's a lawyer-linguist or lawyer-translator, whatever you prefer calling her. She teaches law at a law school, and she researches. She's currently researching language rights as human rights, which sounds very interesting, and we will talk about very soon. And among other things, she's a book lover. She also ran for some time a book club, which was amazing. All related to law, which was really interesting. Well, how about you talk more about yourself now, Paula, so that people can know you better?
Okay, well, thank you, Caroline, for the introduction. And it's always kind of weird to talk about yourself, so I'm going to make it brief. There's not much more than what Caroline already said. I've been in the language profession for longer than I'd like to admit, over 20 years now, which is a very, very long time. And longer than I like to admit, just because that said something about how old I am, and I refuse to get older, even though I have to. Not because I'm not proud of being a translator for such a long time, though. And well, throughout the years, I've done a lot of things that I think have been pretty interesting. I've translated the works of several Nobel Prize winners. I've worked for international organizations as part of the Universal Periodic Review of some Latin American states before the United Nations Human Rights Committee. So I've always been sort of actively involved in legal translation from the point of view of human rights and human rights law and international law. And now I'm sort of trying to connect that with my PhD thesis, which is going to be on language rights as human rights. So that's what Caroline was talking about a second ago when she mentioned my research. And yeah, that's not it, but about as close as I can get.
Well, which is great. You do a lot of things. I'm always amazed at everything you do, especially when it comes to connecting translation and law. How about you start talking about what I don't know, that is your research? I'm very curious about that. Could you talk to us about a little bit more about your research?
Sure. Okay, so a while back I discovered, I discovered an author who discovered many, many years ago that the way that the international community, and by the international community, I mean the international legal community, so I'm thinking of international organizations and different states, the way that we view language rights is as minority rights or as being instrumental to other rights. So when we think of language, a lot of times we think of, for example, language as part of due process might mean having an interpreter when you're in court. And that's one way of looking at language rights. It sort of has an instrumental perspective. We're not looking at language alone. We're looking at it as an instrument to facilitate other rights. And when we look at language rights as minority rights, of course, they're very intricately connected, because linguistic minorities are going to have certain problems when they're in a country where they don't speak the language. That's the whole point of being a minority. But I think language rights are broader than that. And there's really not enough or any actual legislation at the international level that actually says language rights are human rights in their own right. And so that means that when we talk about, for example, the right to our mother tongue, it's very limited right now. The way that we understand a different state's obligations toward us as people who speak a certain language is very limited, and people are being underrepresented and they don't necessarily have access to a lot of things that they would need to have access to. So the way that I'm looking at this is we're looking at it from the wrong place. Right? We shouldn't look at them as either instrumental or just rights as minorities of minorities. We should look at it as everybody's right to their mother tongue, to interact with the state that they live in, regardless of whether or not they were born in that state, in a language that they can understand, to have someone help them out if they don't speak that language. And then, of course, that naturally leads to a requirement, not just of having an interpreter or a translator when you're facing either the court system or the public administration, but also to have professional service. Because a lot of times what happens in many parts of the world is that the people who are providing that service are not professional translators or interpreters. So for example, in the US-Mexico border, you'll maybe have people who are working as janitors come and interpret for someone who is facing maybe an immigration judge. And of course, that's problematic, not because there's anything wrong with the fact that somebody is a janitor, but just with the fact that that person is not the right person to be doing that job. And there's a lot of subject matter expertise that is necessary for that job. And when the state isn't guaranteeing a professional translator or interpreter, my position is that they are violating your human right to language in a way. So it's a little more complicated than that. That's like kind of my oversimplification.
Yeah, obviously. Yeah. But that sounds very interesting, and it's so apt to, especially in the combination that you work with, which is English Spanish, right? Because I think that's Spanish is one of the most spoken languages after English. So I think that's a very important combination. And do you study any country or any area in particular? I'm sorry if I lost that, if you mentioned.
No, I didn't mention that. But so I'm not looking at it just in terms of language pairs. I'm looking at it in general as what are the obligations of states towards people with respect to their language. Because what I found through my research is that there are countries where the official language is not the language of the majority either, for historical reasons. So you've got countries that are former French colonies, former Portuguese colonies, former British colonies that have imposed a language on the population that is actually the official language is the minority language, and the majority speak, for example, indigenous languages or other languages that are not necessarily that particular language, yet they cannot access justice or the public administration in their own mother tongue, even though their mother tongue is technically the mother tongue of the country that they're in. So I'm looking at it from a broader perspective. And I'm at a point in my research where I'm sort of doing a historical account of what countries have official languages, what countries don't have official languages, and looking at the numbers, how many people actually speak the official language, where did that official language come from, who chose it, why was it chosen, and how does that affect people living in those different countries.
Okay, I see. Very interesting. Congratulations. I think it will be an amazing job.
Thank you. I'm trying, I'm trying my best. It's crazy because it's there's just so much, and it's so interesting. And like, the more you learn, the more you want to learn. And it's just one of those situations where you're aware of how ignorant you are. But it's one thing to sort of be aware of our own ignorance as humans. And then it's another thing to sort of look at that pile of books and that pile of information and think, oh, wow, I still have to do something with all of this, even as a tiny, ignorant human.
Yeah, well, but as a nerd as well, you must be very excited to analyze all this data and find interesting things, right, about this.
I am. And it touches me, also on a very personal level, because as your audience doesn't necessarily know this, but I know that you do. I grew up in the US, and in the States, I was the daughter of an immigrant. My mom was from Argentina, raised in Argentina, and she moved to the United States during the dictatorship in Argentina. I was 1 year old when we moved to the States. And she was always a linguistic minority in the US. It was never part of her plan to ever leave Argentina and go anywhere. So her English was very basic. And so when we lived in the States, of course it helped. My father was American, so he helped with language stuff. I spoke English, so I could help. But there were times when my mom was literally being helped by a child, which was me, in doing really important stuff. Like, for example, when she got divorced from my English-speaking father, it was me, like I was in the place of the interpreter at the time. And I remember being a kid and thinking, you know, this can't be right because I don't understand half of what the lawyers are saying. And I still have to try to convey this for my mom. And people, there are millions of people in the world in the same situation as my mom who rely on children or who rely on people who are just not fit to be doing that and shouldn't be in that position in the first place. And their rights are really at stake when they're in that position. So for me, it's what I'm trying to say is that this whole research is obviously at an intellectual level, I find it fascinating. As a translator, I find it fascinating, but it also is very dear to my heart because every single time I read about people, the first thing that comes to mind is my mom and having been there and knowing exactly what that looks like. And how it really affects people's lives. So it's nice to have an area of research where you can see how that translates into practice. I think that's the most exciting thing for me is to see that, okay, all this theory has some kind of practical application somewhere. Yes. And I can show you it.
And I'm curious, are you also an interpreter, Paula?
So funny story, I'm trained as an interpreter. I actually have several degrees as an interpreter, but I've never worked as an interpreter.
Yeah, okay, yeah, I knew that you were a translator, but let me check because your research is going to be very valuable for interpreters mainly, right? It's going to be interesting for everybody, but in practice, I think it will help interpreters a lot because I think these are... Well, they face this reality.
Yeah, absolutely. Ultimately, I think if you never know when you start doing research, if you're actually going to end in the same place where you started. So right now, just the way it looks like my conclusion is going to be that states indeed do have at least some kind of positive obligation to provide professional interpreters. So I think it's going to be an argument in favor of the interpretation profession, and also maybe, and I think that's a subject for somebody else's research, not mine. But then the next question would be, well, really, what kind of interpreter? How do we choose them? How do we train them? I mean, that's like a whole other question. But I do think it does open the door to really asking ourselves to what extent and states have this positive obligation. What does that obligation mean? And how do we fix this?
Okay, very interesting. And what came first, the translator or the lawyer?
So I was a translator first. So for those of you, the audience who doesn't know me, when Caroline, I let her say I'm a nerd, I actually encouraged the word nerd. So I was working as a translator. And I loved legal translation. I loved it a lot. And I already had a part of me that always sort of wanted to go to law school. And so I was between things. I was thinking, okay, I'm going to sign up for school. And I thought, well, what is the best way to become like a really good legal translator? And I thought, oh, I'll go to law school. And I did. So...
pretty simple.
Why not? Yeah, you know, and in Argentina, you know, it's just 5 years of my life, so
it is really hard as well. Oh my god.
Yeah, like what's half a decade? So I signed up, and 5 years later, I was a lawyer.
Good. But, well, it's interesting to know, because usually you have like the opposite, people who are lawyers and become a translator for some reason. But you studied law actually to translate, which is like fascinating. But you are like a great translator dash lawyer, and you give amazing courses on legal translation, and you speak like perfectly. I've learned a lot with you, so I can say that you are a great lawyer dash linguist or translator, whatever people prefer.
Thank you.
It's like the perfect title for you, because it's like you're equally good in both. Something I would like to talk about with you is plain English, because this is a topic I find really interesting and good and important, and it's not talked that much here in Brazil, especially because it refers to English, but I think that the idea can be applied to any other language that we translate into. But could you talk a bit about it, maybe explain what it is and the main idea behind it?
Okay. So I love that question, because it is I think it's something that we do need to talk about more, not just plain English, but just plain language and law in general, right? So a lot of course, there are languages where the whole concept of plain language is inconsistent with how the entire language works. But just parting from the premise that your language admits some form of plain language. So like in Spanish, we have lenguaje claro. I know that in Brazil, you've got a version of like clear or plain sort of Portuguese. The concept of plain language has to do with not dumbing things down, because that's a misconception that many translators often have about plain language. It's not about dumbing it down. It's about acquiring clarity in the way that we write. And when we apply that to translation, and in my case, to legal translation in particular, what that means is don't make it extra complicated. Don't fall for the vices that lawyers will often just not think about. Like, there are a lot of things that in the way that we write, especially lawyers, the things that we deal with are so complex that, of course, legal language has this extra layer of complexity. But plain language in law is about not making it even more complicated by writing in a way that that nobody can wrap their head around what you wrote. So it's about if there's a word, if there's a term of art that fits, by all means use it. But don't use legalese if legalese isn't necessary. If there's a plain word that means the same thing and there's no need for a term of art, or something that looks like a term of art, but a lot of times it's just a misused word or a vice in language, then don't use that. It's about structuring our sentences in a way that's clear. So, for example, one of the guidelines in plain language is to use the active voice more often than the passive voice, just to make it clear who's going to be doing what and when and how. It's really about clarity. And in fact, I would say one of the two largest organizations, plain language organizations in the world, is actually called Clarity International. And they do all sorts of research about plain language. So if you have to like sum it up into one word, I would just say it's about clarity.
Yeah, good. What is a term of art for those who don't know? Because I know it's a tricky term, especially because it, like in the last course you gave with Bruna Marchi from Descomplicando Inglês Jurídico, there was a lot of discussion around the topic, what actually means the term of art. So could you maybe try to explain a bit?
I can try, yes. A term of art is a technical term. In legal language, there are different ways that you can look at it, but like just to keep it really simple, it's a technical term that is going to have a very, very specific meaning in the law. And that meaning is oftentimes going to be, well, not oftentimes, actually scratch that, 100% of the time is going to be linked to what that word means in the legal system that created the concept in the first place. So if I use a word like injunction in English, that's a term of art. It has a very specific meaning. And when a lawyer hears a word injunction, there's like a little light that goes on in their head and they know exactly what we're talking about. When an average person, a lay person, hears the word injunction, they may not know what we're talking about, but lawyers do. So the debate in terms of plain language a lot of times is some people are under the misconception that plain language says never use terms of art, but that's really not one of the guidelines. Actually, the guideline, and if you read some of the leading authors in plain language like Brian Garner, and you look at some of the latest bibliography from Clarity International, from Plain, et cetera, from these different organizations, what they're saying is, you know, if you're writing for lawyers and they're going to understand this one term, or there's a term that means exactly what you want to say, use it. If you're writing for an average person, but there's no better way to say this than by using the exact term of art that the law uses, then use it. But if you're writing for a layperson and there's a better, clearer way to say this that everybody can understand, then, you know, don't use it, then use this other thing. So it really, I think the levels and how we manage plain language has a lot more to do with who the reader is. And we adapt how much will sort of steer away from formality and just the way that we typically write things as lawyers, depending on who's going to be reading the text and what that text is going to be used for. So it's not like about, a lot of times people have this position where they think it's about just taking something really complex and just making it like, excuse the word, but making it idiot proof. And yes, of course it's about idiot proofing it, but but it's not about dumbing it down in the sense that you can still convey a very complex idea using very precise legal vocabulary, but in a way that a human being can understand it. Maybe they'll need to go to the dictionary to understand some of the words that you're using still, because legal language is unintelligible for people who are not lawyers, but it's about helping the reader to really understand what it is, what the message was that was originally intended in that text.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, good. And I think it's a good idea, not obviously that it's really important for legal translation due to the complexity of different systems that we work with to begin with, but also it can be applied for any kind of text. And that's what I think it's important, because sometimes you see, last week I worked for 2 weeks with a text. It was a report that was horrible in the source language, in English. It was English into Portuguese. It was terrible to understand. The language was like, it was not written for someone who knows how to write, or it was badly translated. I don't know what happened, but it was like terrible. And that does not necessarily mean that I have to transpose or to translate this difficult text into a difficult target as well. So we have to try to work it out and try to understand what it means. And what I did was, I learned a lot with that text, because it was almost as if it was a transcreation, you know. I translated it roughly first, and then I would read it again and see that it was horrible and try to tweak it here, tweak it there, and see it in context with the previous sentence and the next sentence to see if it made sense. And we have, in Portuguese, we have to avoid repetition of words. So you have to try to avoid repeating. And the source was very repetitive on terms as well. So I had to avoid this. It was really like I would spend 1-2 hours with 100 words, which is not common for me. I'm usually a fast translator. And it was like, it was something about, like, it was the same idea, like trying to make it clear for the reader to understand in Portuguese, even though the source was horrible and unintelligible most of the time. It was like as if a child wrote it, you know? Even I would write it better in English than the author itself wrote. So I think it can be applied if we have that sense of being a bit more free from the source, because sometimes we are like stuck on the source and we create a block of text into the target similar to the source, and not by like being free. I think that translators usually find it hard to free themselves from the source and try to transcreate it a bit. Don't you think that?
Yeah, I agree 100% with what you're saying. I think with legal translation in particular, it's a little bit different. We're less free than other areas of translation that are more creative. And the reason why we're less free, we're a little bit, I would say, I mean, we're still free, but we're still kind of bound. I mean, we're secondary drafters in something that is, that has to have, that was written with an intended legal effect. So for us in legal translation, fidelity to source means we can't add or take away from the text. There's obviously always the potential for certain things to be lost in translation when you're working across legal systems and you're working across different languages. But whatever is lost in translation shouldn't be lost because of you, the translator. It should be lost because that's just how translation and languages work, right? So it's about, we do have to be faithful to source. Now, the debate in legal translation that I think is interesting is, what does fidelity to source actually mean? Does fidelity to source mean if it's really just poorly written, like what you were saying earlier, does it have to be poorly written in the target language? I don't think so. I mean, personally, my position is it's one thing to be faithful to source. It's another thing to try to just transpose whatever your source language is into the target language and to follow the exact same structure and to be literal and word for word. Because that literality and that word for wordness is really going to lose a lot in translation. You're going to lose part of the intended meaning, and it's not going to be because of just how languages work. It's going to be because of the literality. It's going to be just an unintended effect of forcing words in your target language that wouldn't naturally go together in that way. So for me, like, a good translation is a translation where we have interpreted the text and where we've interpreted it in a way that we know is faithful to source. We're not adding, we're not taking anything away from it. We're respecting the source text. We're aware of our place as secondary drafters, but at the same time, we're respecting the target language. We're respecting how people communicate in the target language in similar contexts. And we're giving them a text that sounds natural to them, that doesn't sound look like a translation, and that's not going to make the reader just look at it and think, what? I mean, you know, if you look at it and think, what? There's something wrong with that translation. I mean, even if the source text kind of made you stop and think a little bit, you know, there's no need to reflect that in your translation. You can always, you understood it, right? I mean, you have to have understood it to be able to translate it. And in that process of understanding it, you can phrase it in a way that is clear in your own, in the target language. So I guess what I'm trying to say is, I think what's behind what you were saying is really understanding the source text, mm-hmm. which is why I think so many translators are so stuck to the source text. I think it's because they're not taking the time sometimes to really understand it and to capture that the intended message, and then to, you know, phrase that in a way that other people can understand.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think that's it. This text, for example, this report I worked with, it was very long. It has like 32,000 words. It was not that it was difficult to understand. It was easy to understand, but it was, as I said, it was like a child wrote it, because it was very basic, with it was repetitive, and sometimes Portuguese is usually longer than English, and many sentences, my translation was really shorter than the source, which is really rare. This does not happen at all. Usually the translation is much longer than the source itself. And but that was like, it was really weird. I would see on Trados like the strings, and they were like really shorter than the source, and I was like, did I translate it right? I had to double check every time. But it was that, because it was really repetitive. And what is the idea? This is the idea, and I can say it with fewer words. Then I think it's much better than being repetitive and saying the same thing over and over again. You know, it gets tiring, especially in such a long report. So yeah, I think that's great. And are there any tips or special tips that you like to give translators? Because let me go back. I think that legal translator is not an area or not an area of specialization that is like the other ones, like engineering and I don't know, maybe IT, which is a work with, or any other areas. It is very particular because it depends on systems, right? On the system of each country. So do you think that legal translation is especially difficult, or is one of the most difficult areas to translate?
So yeah, that's a really good question. I would say, I'd say it has a difficulty that makes it unique compared to other areas of translation. And I think each area has its own challenges, right? Like if you look at literary translation, I would never be able to translate a work of literature because I just don't have that beautiful sort of writing style that can captivate a reader. Like that's just not me. I'm just very straightforward and just say what I mean and mean what I say, and that's it. So, you know, it and that's a challenge that I think makes literary translation very difficult, and I admire people who can do that. So I think if we go and we look at all these different areas of translation, we're going to find that they each have challenges that make them unique and that translators will have to overcome. When it comes to legal translation, I think there's an extra layer of responsibility that we have to be aware of when we're translating. And it's the fact that if you don't know about the two legal systems that you're working with, you should not be translating. You need to understand the law to be able to translate legal texts and to do it really well. So a lot of times people think, you know, when it comes to legal translation, they think, oh, it's legal, you can just be literal. And that's actually the worst mistake that you can make. And, you know, just to give you an example and following up on what you were saying, Caroline, like I always like to use the example of medical versus legal translation. When you're a medical translator, a brain is a brain. A brain doesn't change, right? It's just once you know the word brain, and you know it in the different languages that you work with, that's it. There's really, it's a matter of maybe having like a better writing style or knowing how to research your vocabulary. I mean, there's a whole set of skills that you're going to need that are very important skills, but your subject matter is static. In every area of translation, the subject matter is going to be static. In the law, the subject matter is not static. It's not static because the beasts that exist in one legal system don't exist in other legal systems. And sometimes, even if a similar beast exists in one legal system, we might understand it slightly differently, to the point where words that look like they could go in context maybe don't necessarily go in context. Maybe if you're doing procedural law, it depends on what point of the procedure you're in, and it's going to be a word can mean something different. You're translating a contract. It depends on where a word is in a contract. It might mean something different. So you have to be aware of the law behind that. And in addition to the fact that you're working with, you know, two things that are just similar but not quite. I mean, the law is really not even similar sometimes within the same country, like from one jurisdiction to another, let alone when you go from one country to another. In addition to that, the law changes constantly. So it changes with society. And so you've got words that that are going to be popping in all the time, or we're going to start understanding different things with them, or we're going to start using them differently. So it's really not a static subject matter, and you can't treat it as a static subject matter. So a lot of times when I train translators, they'll say, you know, where can I get a good bilingual dictionary? It's, well, you know, it doesn't really matter if you have a good bilingual dictionary. You need so much more. The bilingual dictionary is like this, and, yeah, and you need all this. So I don't want to say that it's more difficult, but I do want to say that it's different, and it's unique in that sense, in the sense that it does have this extra challenge. And everything you write as a legal translator, it carries a certain amount of responsibility. I mean, you know, the law deals with things that are really at the core of people's lives. We're talking about people's freedoms. We're talking about people's, family situation, like when two people get divorced, who's going to keep the kid? If you're going to sell your house, what can you do with your money? How are you going to sell this? I mean, really what's at stake is very important, and it affects people's lives at a very profound level. So there's a very big responsibility when you're a legal translator to be very aware of how accurate you have to be, how much research you have to do. And, you know, you have to really, you have to really keep that in mind all the time, because it's not a tiny mistake. It's like with medical, you know, if maybe you make a mistake or somebody could die. With legal translation, if you make a mistake, somebody can lose a right. And a right is a big deal that you don't want to lose ever. Mm-hmm. So I would say, you know, they're all difficult. This one is not to scare anyone, of course. I mean, these are all skills that you can acquire. But really what I like to stress when I talk to people who are interested in legal translation is just know when you're coming into this that you need to acquire this skill, that you have a responsibility to do so and to understand the law when you're going to be a legal translator.
And that being said, do you think that obviously having a degree in law helps a lot, but do you think that translators need to be lawyers, or do you think that taking courses, obviously we need to study, but do you think that taking courses and studying on the side is enough?
So I think it depends on the person. Personally, I'm a person who needed to go to law school, because I just feel like I'm one of those people who have to do, like, you know, just go that extra mile. It's just who I am. But I don't think you necessarily have to be a lawyer to be a good legal translator. I think what you do have to be is very, very good at doing research, at understanding the subject matter. And the law is something that, if you think about it, it's law schools aren't that old compared to other professions, right? So, I mean, the law is a practice. We actually describe it as a practice. And just like any practice, it's something that you can learn at a practical level. It helps to have structure, though. It always helps to have someone guide you in that process. So, you know, you don't have to go to law school, but maybe take legal translation courses, but not just legal translation courses. Don't stop at the bilingual, how do you say this word or that word? Take courses that are on comparative law, for example, or take courses about the legal systems that you work with the most. Take courses about your own country's legal system and your source country's legal system. So the more you know, the better prepared you're going to be an excellent legal translator. And the standard, which I always credit Chris Durbin for this, even though I'm adapting it to the law, but I remember one time, I don't know where it was, that somebody asked her, how do you know when you're ready to translate at the premium level that she always talks about? And yeah, she said, you know, if you can have an intelligent conversation with an expert on the subject matter, doesn't mean you have to be an expert as well, but you have to be able to have an intelligent conversation on that subject matter. And I heard her and I thought, this is brilliant. She's absolutely right. And it applies to legal translation. If you can have an intelligent conversation about legal issues with a lawyer, you're ready to translate that subject matter in the law. If you can't, or you can't follow a lawyer in the subject matters that you intend to work with, like if you maybe listen to Kenneth Adams talk about contracts for 40 minutes and you get lost, then you're not ready to translate contracts. You need to learn a little bit more. Mm-hmm. That's sort of the standard.
And the opposite, lawyers who want to start being a translator, do you think that it's also maybe the same, or is it easier?
So I would say we have a problem, which is that they convince us in law school that we're good writers, and that's not true. Right? So first, the first thing we need to do if we're lawyers who intend to translate is we need to learn we need to learn how to write well. We need to learn as much as we can about the target language, because we're going to have the law. And of course, the target language is going to be our mother tongue. So we're going to think that we're excellent writers. But just because we think we're excellent writers in our mother tongue, it doesn't mean that we are. Just because our law school professors told us that we're excellent writers, that doesn't mean that we are. So we are going to have to train ourselves in developing those good writing skills, because after all, you know, we are secondary drafters. So we're not writing an original. It's derivative work, but still it has to be well written. So I would recommend really studying the target language and how that language works and acquiring that skill. And also a thing that I always say is I always like to recommend that people team up. So, you know, if you're a lawyer and you want to translate legal text, maybe team up with a translator to edit your work, or vice versa. If you're a translator and, you know, you want to translate well, team up with a lawyer to edit your work and guide you in the law. Just look for whatever you don't have, look for it in somebody else and collaborate with other people, because, you know, collaboration is sort of the essence of humanity, right? It's how we evolved to where we are today. And so there's no reason not to collaborate in our professional endeavors as well.
Yeah, that's a great tip. Great idea. Loved it. Well, are there any other tips you would give to legal translators or those who want to become legal translators?
Well, I would say if you're a nerd, if you love reading and you love the law and you're an intellectually honest person and you remain intellectually humble and aware of how much you're always going to have to learn throughout your entire life, because it never ends, then go for it. if you tick all those boxes, go for it. And yeah, because we do need good legal translators. So mm-hmm. Yeah, I would encourage people to go for it.
And do you have any courses going on or to be released soon?
I do. So I am going to be teaching a course on legal concepts and terminology via Training for Translators with Corinne Mackay. Mm-hmm. So that's Corinne's online academy. And the course, I believe, starts in October, if I'm not mistaken. I don't know the exact date, but it's going to be around those dates. And after I'm done teaching that course, I am going to teach the second edition of my comparative law course for legal translators. But this time I'm actually keeping it language specific. So this time my comparative law course is going to be Spanish English. The first edition that I did last year was just comparative law. And this year I'm going to go into the specifics of that comparative language as well.
Okay, great. I will leave the links to the courses in the notes below, so that if people are interested. I did the first one, right? If I'm not mistaken.
You did.
Yeah.
And you have lifetime access, so you'll be able to take the new version with the updates.
Oh, yay. It was really helpful, because even though Spanish is different from Portuguese, but since both are Latin, I could follow the course. And the main ideas, I think, that apply to translation in general, and taking into consideration that the source is from English, it was very helpful. I learned a lot. And the basic concepts part of the course is really, really important and valuable information. So I really learned a lot, and I never cease to learning from you. That every course I take, I learn something new, which is amazing. So that's why I invited you. Thanks a lot, Paula, for taking the time to be interviewed. It was a pleasure, as always.
Thank you so much. I enjoyed it as well. And I'm just going to say this for your audience. Caroline is one of my favorite people in translation. I tell her this all the time, but I'm just saying it here just so you guys know that just how much I appreciate her, and you should follow her forever and support everything she does because she's awesome. That's my tip. That's my tip for translators. Be like Caroline. She's great.
Come on. Well, it means a lot to me. As you know, it means a lot coming from you because you are like the feeling is totally mutual. I really admire you, the job you do, and you as a person. Like, you were one of the most fantastic people and women in translation. You should be one of my greatest women in translation series on the blog. I don't know why people haven't nominated you. If I had the control over it, you would definitely be one of them. Because you are also great. So thank you very much for your appreciation and your kind words. And the feeling is totally mutual. Thanks a lot, Paul.
Okay, and thank you for whoever is watching or listening. So for those who are just listening, I just waved, even though you can't see it.
Yeah, great.
Why not?
Thanks a lot. Thank you, everyone, for listening. And talk to you and see you in the next episode. Bye-bye.